Come on, new life. Let's worship the Lord this morning. Hallelujah. I've got a fire. I've got a fire burning. Burning inside of me. Oh, oh, oh. I've got a fire.
Fire, the one that I desire, you're the one, the only one consuming fire.
in on our prayer time. Lord, baptize us with the fire, God. Lord, we love you. Hallelujah.
I want to sing a new song and shout it out loud.
There is a place
where we
your name. Lord, we love you, Jesus. I will praise you, Jesus. I will praise you, God, because you thought that I was worth it all. You thought, Lord, that dying on the cross, Jesus, you saw fit, oh God. You seen me, Lord. You have a plan, oh God. You have a plan, oh God. You thought I was worth saving, so you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping, so you came.
Change my
So you cleaned us up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life so I could be free, so I could be whole, so I could tell everyone I know. Hallelujah. Somebody bless him for saving you. Bless him today.
Thank you, Jesus.
You're worth it all. You're worth every drop of blood, every stripe. I was worth it, God.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on.
I was worth it, God.
Come on. How many of you are thankful that he shed on blood on Calvary? Nobody else thought I was worth it, but Jesus thought I was worth it. Everybody else might have thought I didn't amount to much of anything, but Jesus saw it very, very differently. He thought I was worth saving. He thought I was worth going to Calvary for. He thought I was worth shedding his blood for. And I'm just telling you, I never want to disgrace that by treating his grace and mercy second-handedly. But I always want to show my thankfulness, my love and appreciation for the mercy and the grace that Jesus has shown to me. Had it not been for Jesus, where would I be? Clap your hands one more time to the Lord if you know he is good here today. Such an honor to be in the house of the Lord today. You can be seated for just a moment. I'm going to make a few announcements here, and we're going to move right into our service here today. First of all, I need to make a very special announcement. Tap the person next to you and say, make sure you're listening. If they didn't even act like you touched them, hit them a little harder and tell them, make sure you're listening. It just so happens that one of our favorite evangelists that we like around here at New Life happens to be in the Middle Tennessee area, and he contacted me just the other day and said, I will be in Middle Tennessee. Are you interested in having us come by? And I said, absolutely. And so tonight's service, Brother Tim Green will be with us tonight. And so you want to make sure you're here. Amen. Make sure that you're here tonight. Bring somebody with you. We expect God just to move in a tremendous way, as he does every time. Not only that we're in the house of the Lord, but there's just a special connection with Brother Green and this church. And so we want you to be prepared for that tonight. And we are excited about him being with us tonight. It's good to have all of our guests here with us this morning. Thank you so much for taking time out to be with us today. And it's good to have Gina Turner with us here all the way from Dyersburg, guest of Sister Tina Turner. So we're good, glad to have her here with us today. Amen. Make all of our guests welcome in the house of the Lord. We're so honored to have them today. We're going to be doing something here in just a little bit, and that is the Lord has blessed us in such a tremendous way this year with church growth by the way of natural church growth. And we have a lot of babies being born around here this year, and so we are going to take a first part of the year dedication, and then we're going to take a second part of the year dedication for the second half. And so this morning we're going to be dedicating three children here today as part of the message that I have for you here today. And so I want the parents and the children being dedicated, if they will, to start making their way to this front row that we have reserved for you. Sometimes the only way I can get some of you to sit on the front row, right in front of me. And so while they're doing that, I also want to say it is an honor for us to have visiting with us this weekend. He came all the way from Lafayette, Indiana, to hear me preach today. None of y'all even believe that. But it is good to have Josh Gothra with us here today. He is an IBC alum, and he is here this weekend helping us out, playing, checking out Smithfield, seeing if maybe he feels a calling to the area. I think he... Boy, did I just put pressure. I mean, I just threw you right out there with a flying bus coming by. Maybe he just feels a little drawing to the Smithville area, beautiful Middle Tennessee, Smithville, Tennessee. And maybe God's just working on his heart that maybe he ought to relocate from ugly Indiana to beautiful Tennessee. That's about all the emotion I get out of him most of the time too. So, but it is good to have him here with us this morning. It's such an honor to have him here today. Before we get started here today, we want to do a little presentation as we often do and show a little video of all of these precious young men that we are dedicating here today. It's an honor to have families also with us here today that are extended family here, but we want to show you just this little video here this morning in honor of these children. I would sing, but I don't think I was intended to. Well, I just have to say, ladies, the boys have arrived. Got some good looking boys. I'm not sure, Michael, if which one of those pictures he looked more like you, if it was the screaming one or the yawning one. I'm trying to figure out which one that is. Today in this house, we celebrate not only the presence of God, but an opportunity to do something that is very, very biblical. The dedication of these three children here this morning. As a matter of fact, 1 Samuel, and Brother Brandon, I didn't get these to you, so you'll just have to keep up this morning. But 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse number 11 says, "Then she made a vow to the Lord, O Lord of hosts, if you will indeed look on the affliction of your maidservant and remember me and not forget your maidservant, but I will give your maidservant a male child, then," and here's the key, "I will give him to the Lord all the days of his life." And then in the 25th through the 28th verse, we find where she comes back to the prophet Eli and brings that child to Eli in verse 25, and then in verse 26, she says to him and reminds him, "I am the woman who stood by you here praying to the Lord. I was the one that was praying to the Lord." And she says this in verse 27, "For this child I prayed, and the Lord has granted me my petition which I ask of him. Therefore, because I have asked God for this blessing, therefore I also have lent him to the Lord. As long as he lives, he shall be lent to the Lord. And they worship the Lord there. I want you to understand this morning that this is not just a routine. It's not just a tradition, if you will, but it is a God-inspired moment in a child's life where a parent promises back to God the gift or the blessing or the promise that they have received. And I want you to also understand that this does not save the child. I need you to make sure that we understand that. We're not going to come up and baptize the child. This does not save the child. There is still so much more work that needs to be done, and especially on the parent's part. I wish there were some way that I could just sprinkle a little dust and say some special prayer and these children would be eternally secure, but that's just not the way it works. It's not the way that it works, and we have to understand here today, as the scripture says, to raise a child in the way that they must go, and when they are old, they will not depart from it. That also does not mean that just simply by raising them, they're eternally saved either. They will have their own will, and they must bring that will into line with the things that they have been taught and the things that they have been shown. If we don't teach it, then we can't expect that they're just going to do it. You got to teach it. And if we don't teach it, then we can't expect that it's just going to happen. But somewhere along the way, their will, our prayer is, as we give them back to God, is that their will get in line with God's purpose in their life. And the only way they know about God's purpose in their life is that they have to be taught about God's purpose in their life. Does that make sense? And so that's why the scripture must be a proclamation, if you will, to every generation that's found in Psalms 145. And verse number 4, Psalms 145 and 4 simply says this, that one generation shall praise thy works to another and shall declare thy mighty acts. One generation shall praise thy works to another. This is probably a scripture that is used at many baby dedications, and so it is appropriate here this morning that we use that scripture as well, because this generation has to praise the works of God to the next generation. They have to tell of the mighty acts of God. And it's not just these parents that are here this morning, but I hope you understand that as part of the church of God, as part of the family of God, each and every one of us have a responsibility to send out those same praises and praise the works of God from this generation to the next. I need my elders telling us in this generation how God has blessed them, how God has touched them, how God has used them, how God has moved in their lives. I need my elders telling us and praising God for how he's brought them through and how he's brought them out. I need my elders to tell us, but not just my elders to us. It doesn't need to stop in that generation, but the next generation needs to be telling the children and the teenagers and the college and career. You need to understand there is nothing better than the house of God. There is nothing more important than the temple of God. You need to understand what God will do. And so this morning, with the pieces of the tabernacle on stage, and of course this really, we're not teaching on it here this morning, but I am going to tie it in this morning, as I will probably Father's Day as well, because this is an intricate part of what we are and what we do. But if you're missing prayer on Tuesday nights, you're missing about what happens in here when we begin to talk about these pieces of the tabernacle. But with them on the stage, I want to speak to the parents of these children this morning, but as well to all of us that are here today about the importance of the temple. I need you to understand how important, before we leave here today, that the temple really is. For all of us today, if the importance of this temple is not passed down from one generation to the next generation, we will cease, please listen to me, to acknowledge it as a house of God where he dwells and where he belongs and where he moves. If we do not pass down the importance of this temple, if we do not pass down the importance of what happens in this temple, we will cease to acknowledge it as the place where God dwells. What will happen that has happened in so many other facilities and places, if you will, what will happen is that we begin treating it as a place where we socialize, as a place where we come to compare ourselves with each other, as a place where we go through a routine, but not a place where God dwells. The importance of the temple. Look at somebody next to you and tell them the temple's important. Our relationship with God should be the number one priority in our lives. I thought I might get at least two or three that would agree with me. Our relationship with God should be our number one priority in our lives. I don't have time to spend with you this morning on this topic. I just need you to believe it with me. It's not my job. It's not my career. It's not my success. It's not my money in the bank. It's not my name. It's not who I am. It's not what I can accomplish. My number one priority in my life ought to be my relationship with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. My relationship with God is first in my life. If you don't believe that, then I need to preach another message talking about why it's important. But it should be the number one priority in our lives. And if it is, then please hear this next statement. If it is the number one priority, then it will not be a challenge transferring the importance of it to the next generation. It's just so hard to talk to my children about God. Well, that's because He's not a priority in your life. Well, can I be pastor a little bit here today? Is it all right for our guests? We just love you and are glad you're here. For church members, I'm fixing to get real with us a little bit. Okay? We need to understand something here today. If we say it's difficult for me to transfer this to my children, it's because I don't love it like I should. It's not a priority like it should be. Because if it's a priority in my life, I promise you, the transitioning and the transferring of the importance of the temple, of the importance of a relationship with God, is not difficult because they see it acted out in our lives each and every day. It just becomes habit. It just becomes what we do. There is no question about, do we have to go to church today? The statement is, do we get to go to church today? There should be no question about, are we involved in the church? There should just be a question about, where can we be involved in the church? It's something I do every day of my life. And if it's a priority in my life, then it's not a hard transfer. We have so many examples in Scripture of parents who taught their children the importance of the temple and the importance of a relationship with God. They taught them, and some of them in very extreme ways, taught their children the importance of a relationship with God, the importance of that temple, of that place where God dwells, that place where God belongs. And we have to teach the next generation. They need to see, please hear me, they need to see proof of why we trust in God the way we do. They need to see proof as to why we do that. It's more than me just saying, well, we trust God. Why do we trust God? Let me show you why I trust God. Because I place everything else behind Him because He's first. I trust God. I don't know how we're going to get groceries this week. There ought to be some of you that can witness to this fact. I've been there and wondered how the bills are going to get paid and where the groceries are coming from. But we just decided, I'm just going to trust Jesus. And when I trust God, it's amazing how things just happen and stuff just shows up. And somebody might say it's a coincidence, but if you really know God, you know it's not a coincidence. It's God moving because I trust Him. Come on, somebody. You know how you teach the next generation? You show them what it means to trust God. Abraham, was in such a extreme way of proving this to his son Isaac. He offered him up as a sacrifice. I'm not saying that that's what you need to do here today to prove, but let me just use it as an example. In Genesis 22, verses 5 through 12, I'm just going to kind of hop through these this morning as I move through this here today. But in verse number 5 of chapter 22 of Genesis, he said to the men that went with him, he said, stay here with the donkey, and the lad and I go yonder to worship, and we will come back to you. I need you to notice something in that scripture, and I know we've preached on this before, but you need to recognize as we go through this today, I want you to pay attention to some things. It says, the lad and I will go yonder to worship. First of all, he was taking him with him when he went to worship. He didn't leave him at home. Boy, I told you I'm going to get real here for a little bit this morning. Sorry, y'all get to hear it. But listen to me. He said, the lad and I go yonder to worship. He didn't leave him back doing something else because it wasn't important to go with dad to worship. He didn't leave him back doing something else because it wasn't important for him to worship. And if you notice, as we get through this, they also worshiped together as we get through this scripture, which tells me he didn't just let him go sit off on the side and work on something else while he was worshiping. Can I help you a little bit today? We got to teach our kids how to pray. The only way we teach them how to pray is bring them down and help them pray. We got to teach them how to worship. The only way we teach them how to worship is that we worship with them. I'm just going to be real. Again, I love you. You know I love you. I don't have to preface anything I'm saying. I love you today. I feel a little dangerous today. So you just need to know I love you, okay? But here's what you have to understand. When they come down here to worship, it's not good enough to let the other young people show them how to worship. You ought to be showing them how to worship. Go ahead and tuck your toes under the pew because it's going to get real for a little bit. When I come to prayer, I don't want them playing and writing and drawing and doing something. Now, they can do that for a little while. Please hear me. It's okay because I know their attention span is about that of a gnat. All right? I understand. I've had three. I understand how this works. But I also understand that if I don't take out some time in that process to say, now listen, this is why we come here. This is what we do. Come here, James, let me use you for a second. James, this is why we come here on Tuesday nights. It's because we get down here at the altar and we begin to pray and we talk to God and we ask God and we praise God and we thank God. This is what we do. This is why we're here. They don't need to know that's just someplace that mom and dad go on Tuesday night or that church is just someplace they go on Sunday. They need to bring them down and say, James, when we get to the house of God, this is what we do. We dance before the Lord. We clap our hands. We lift up our voices. We magnify and we worship. Now listen, when he gets this age, he ought to be able to do it for the whole service. Now this is no reflection. I'm using James as an example. Nobody read into this, okay? I'm using him as an example. But by the time he gets to this point, there should have been something already taught inside of him that says, that's what I do when I go to church. But when they're this size, it's not going to last that long because their attention span's not there. They're going to have to get up and go out to the nursery because they need to eat. Or they're going to need to get up and go out to the nursery because they... Uh-oh. They're going to have to get up and go out. But for a few minutes anyway, while we're in service, they ought to see their eyes as big as they can be. Look at mom. Look at dad. What are they doing? We go to church and there's music playing and something's happening. And mom and dad got their hands lifted. They're worshiping. They're dancing. They're lifting up the name of Jesus. You ought to make sure they know. He said, we took him with us. So the first statement he made was that I'm taking him up there with me to worship. So they did it together. But he also said, we're going to come back to you. That's where he began to trust God because he knew God gave me this blessing. God's not going to take it away from me. I don't know how he's going to do it. I know he told me to go up there and sacrifice my son. I don't know how it's going to happen, but I trust God. And he goes on to say, so Abraham took the wood and the burnt offering, and he laid it upon Isaac, his son, and he took the fire in his hand and a knife, and the two of them went again together. And Isaac spoke to Abraham, his father, and he said, my father. And he said, here am I, son. And he said, look to the fire and look to the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering? And Abraham said, my son, God will provide himself a lamb. And again, third time it says, so the two of them went together. And then, verse number 9, then they came to the place where God had told them. He brought them to the temple. He brought them to the place because Abraham built an altar there and placed the wood in order. And then he bound his son Isaac and he laid him upon the altar and upon the wood. Now, I don't know. I've never been put in this situation. I cannot even begin to imagine what's going through his head right now. I can't even begin, and neither can you, because we've not been put in that position. We've not been put in that place. But I can't even begin to fathom what it must have felt like for Abraham to say, God, you told me this. God, I'm trusting you. God, I'm believing in you. God, I've got faith in you. If I put my son on this altar, if I give him back to you the blessing that you have given me, if I place him here, God, I am teaching him something. I am showing him that you are the most important thing in my life. As much as I love my son, as much as I love my only called out son, as much as I love him, you are the most important thing in my life. And I can imagine as it's going through Abraham's head, is God going to stop it? Is God going to do something in the process? Is God going to raise him back up after he's dead? I don't know what's going to happen, but I trust God. And then verse 10 tells us that the Lord, the angel, came and called to him from heaven. And he said, Abraham. And he told him, he said, don't lay a hand on the lad or do anything to him. And here's the key. He said, for now I know. Now I know. Right now the Lord's telling him, now I know. But guess who else knows? That son that was laying on that altar now knows that if you trust God, God will provide. He looked over and found the sacrifice tied up over in the bushes. He said, now I know. That's how we teach the next generation. That's how we tell the next generation, is that they see us trusting God. Hebrews 11:17 said, by faith, Abraham, when he was tested. Not when everything was going smooth, not when everything was perfect, but when he was tested. When he was tested, Hebrews 11:17 says, by faith, when Abraham was tested, he offered up Isaac, and he who had received the promises offered up his only begotten son. Please understand, it was the first dedication process. He had received a blessing from God, and he turned around and gave that blessing back to God, and God honored it. God blessed it. God caused things to happen and progress through that lineage because he was willing to give back to God. Exodus chapter 2, there's a story about a young man named Moses. And many of us know the story, and we understand the story. If you were in Sunday school at all, you know the story, but Pharaoh had ordered the death of all the Hebrew boys, all the Hebrew boys that were being born. He had ordered the death of them, and he was having midwives watch out for it and make sure that it was taking place. And so here we find in Exodus chapter 2, in verse number 2, it says that the woman conceived and bore a son, and she hid him for 3 months because of this decree that had gone out to kill every one of the Hebrew boys. And so she hid him for 3 months. And then verse 3 said she could no longer hide him, and so she took an ark out of the bulrushes for him and dabbed it with asphalt and pitch, and the child put the child in it and laid him in the reeds by the river's bank, put him out into the water, into the river. And as you read the story, his sister stood afar off to watch what was happening. And then in verse 5, she saw the ark among the reeds. Pharaoh's daughter saw this ark among the reeds, and she sent a maid to go get it. And verse number 6, as they opened it up and saw the child in there and the baby's crying, and they see this child in there. Of course, anybody who opens up a floating basket in the river and finds a child in it crying is going to find that next word, compassion. It's so hard to open that up and see that child and for Pharaoh's daughter to go, well, we got to kill this one. It wasn't happening. God put it into place. God put things into order. And so she said, this is one of the Hebrews' children. And then verse 7, his sister said and found an opportunity, say, can I go and call a nurse for you from the Hebrew women that she may nurse the child for you? And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, go. And so the maiden went and called the child's mother. Look how God put it all back together. When mama trusted God, God made it happen where it needed to happen. God took care of it the way that it needed to. And then verse 9 says, take this child away, nurse him for me, and I will give you wages. She got paid to take care of her own child. That's the best stay-at-home mom job ever. She got paid to take care of her own child. And she said, I'll give you the wages. And so the woman took the child and she nursed him. And the child grew and she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter. And he became her son. And she called his name Moses, saying, because I drew him out of the water. You have to understand, mom had to get to the point. I can't imagine again as a father putting my child on an altar to sacrifice. As a mother, I'm sure you cannot imagine placing your child into a basket and sending it down a river where crocodiles and snakes and any other animal could get a hold of them in the process, and worried about what's going to happen to that child. But knowing that I trust God, if I'll just trust God, if I'll get this word down deep on the inside of him, if I'll let him understand that God will always be there to carry us, if I'll trust God, then God will see him through. And it just comes around full circle where she gets to raise him up, her own son. He doesn't see death, but he gets to raise up in a Hebrew home. He gets to learn the words, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. He gets to hear those words. He gets to understand who he really is. He gets to understand who God really is and how to trust God. And then there's one other story I can share with you. And that is when Joseph and Mary left Jesus in the temple. Luke chapter 2, 40 through 49. I'll just pick up some of the scriptures out of this, but Luke 2, 40 through 49, it said, the child grew and became strong in spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. His parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover. Please notice something. They didn't miss one because they didn't feel like going. They didn't miss a church service because they didn't feel like going. So they made it to the Passover every single year. They traveled every single year to the feast of the Passover. And when he was 12 years old, they went up to Jerusalem according to the custom of the feast. Please notice something here. Every year until the boy was 12 years old, I just used James as an example. Every year until he was 12 years old, they had been taking him to that feast. They had been taking him back to Jerusalem. They had taken him back to the house. They had taken him back to the temple. Every year. So it just became customary for him. It was just something that he knew was going to happen. And so when they finished the days, they went to return, and the boy Jesus lingered behind in Jerusalem, and Joseph and his mother didn't know it. And then it goes on to say, supposing he had been with the company, and they had went a day's journey, and they sought him and knew he wasn't there. And so they went, when they did not find him, it says in verse 45, they returned to Jerusalem seeking him. Verse number 6, it was after 3 days that they found him, and they found him where? They found him in the temple. After 3 days of mom and dad not being there, they found the 12-year-old in the house of God. I wish I could just let that sink for just a few minutes. They didn't find him over at the game station. They didn't find him down at the river swimming. They didn't find him out playing ball with some boys. They found their 12-year-old son after 3 days in the temple. Do you know why they found him in the temple? Because mom and dad had made the temple a priority in their lives. It was important in their lives. The temple was important to them. And so because the temple was important to them, it was important to their son. Well, that didn't work, Pastor. Nice try to use the scripture, but he was Jesus. That's where he was going to be anyway. He was still a boy who still had to be taught. It said in the first verse I read to you that he grew in knowledge and wisdom. He had to be taught in order to have it. And so when they couldn't find him, they went and found him. He was sitting in the temple amongst the midst of the teachers, both listening to him and asking him questions. The 12-year-old's running the show. And verse 47, and all who heard him were astonished at his understanding and his answers. And so when they saw him, they were amazed. Mom and dad were shocked. His mother said to him, son, why have you done this to us? Look, your father and I have sought you anxiously. I want you to notice something. When they saw him in the temple, they were amazed. Can I share something with you? If you make God a priority in your life, if you make a relationship with God a priority in your life, don't get shocked when your children do the same thing. Hang on, let me say that again because that was really good, but I think 4 of you got it. If I make my relationship with God a priority in my life, then I'm not going to be amazed when I see a worshiper down here that happens to be my child. I'm not going to be amazed when I see a singer that happens to be my child. I'm not going to be amazed when I see a musician that happens to be my child. I'm not going to be amazed when I see my children teaching a Bible study to their school friends. I'm not going to be amazed when I see them making the temple important because I made it important in my life. Why would you be surprised? And so they saw him. They were amazed. They said, didn't you know what you did to us? We've been nervous. We've been looking for you all over the place. And he simply said to them, I don't know why you seek me anywhere else. Didn't you know where I'd be? I'd be about my father's business. I'm just doing what I've been taught. I'm just doing what I've been showed is important in my life. And so let me, as I come to a close here this morning, let me tie this back up with the scripture that we began with in Psalms 145. But I'm going to start with verse number 1. It says, I will extol thee, my God, O King, and I will bless thy name forever and ever. Every day, everybody say every day. Every day will I bless thee. We've been teaching on Wednesday nights about prayer and how it happens continually. Every day will I bless thee, and I will praise thy name. How long? Forever and ever. ever. Let me break it down into modern day terminology that our children would understand, to infinity and beyond. He says in verse number 3, he says, "Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable." Just look at how all that says. He said he's great, he's greatly to be praised, and I just want you to understand, I can't even find how great he is. He's so great, you can't even magnify him for how great he is. You can't even imagine how great he is. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, his greatness is unsearchable. And in the process of all this, he then says, "One generation shall praise thy works to another and shall declare thy mighty acts." What he's saying is, I'm letting my children know that great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. And you're not going to find anything greater than God on the planet. There's nothing more important than God. His works that he has done, his acts that he has done. I'm going to tell you about it till you get tired of hearing it. I'm going to tell you about it till you can't hear it anymore. I want you to know there's nothing as great as God. Why don't you clap your hands to the Lord? There's nothing as great as God. I want you to be successful. I want you to be important. I want you to make a lot of money because I need you to take care of me when I get old. I want you to do all of those things, but I need you to understand, nothing is more important than your relationship with God. I want music to get ready, but if it's okay, I know I've already asked this once, but I'm going to ask it again. Because I'm going to talk to you three in particular for the next couple of minutes. Is it okay if I'm pastor for just a moment and speak direct? Do I not have to candy coat anything this morning? Still going to love me when we're done? I just need at least a head nod so I know we're okay. Right? Noah, everything's good, right? Noah's relaxed and just paying attention. We must show the generation that follows the importance of the temple. We have to show them. Please hear me. We can't just assume that they'll catch on. We can't just assume that they're going to get it. I've often said, and you've heard me say this if you've been here for any length of time, that what is not preached is not practiced. The reason people get away from things that are principles in Scripture, whether it be separation, whether it be giving, whatever it may be, if they get away truth and doctrine and Jesus' name back, the reason churches get away from those things is because what's not preached is not practiced. Bottom line, what's not preached is not practiced. And so let me bring that home to where you live here today and tell you that what is not taught is not learned. If you don't teach it, they can't learn it. I wish that you could just go in and just lay the Bible on their head at night when they sleep. Might get in trouble for that, but if you lay it on their head at night while they sleep and just all of this just drops down into their brain and their heart and their spirit, I wish it was that easy, but it's not. Because what's not taught is not learned. If I don't teach them, they're not going to know. They must know that there is nothing more important than the presence of God. There is no place more vital in their lives than the temple. There is no place more vital. What you need to understand is that we're showing the next generation what it would take to progress the message of God. In order for the message to move forward, we've got to teach the next generation what it takes. They are the next ones. They had to be shown the right way. One generation shall praise your name to the next generation. It has to be handed down. Last night, we were at the dedication of the building in Fayetteville that many of our men went and worked on, and what a tremendous blessing it was to see the labor that we had invested turning into a lighthouse in that community. What a tremendous, tremendous place. We took some pictures. Maybe at some point we'll put them up and show you. But what a beautiful, beautiful facility. What a powerful move of God that we felt in there last night as we dedicated that place for the work of God. And we know that Brother and Sister Lewis are going to do a tremendous job. They've already doubled since they've been there and hadn't even had a church to do it in. And so God is tremendously blessing them. And so we were so thankful to be a part, that we could just be a part of something that will continue to succeed because God is in it. And I walked into, and again, let me just be transparent for a moment, but I walked into the baptismal room, Brother Joe. And as I walked into that room, it quickly rushed into my mind the words that Brother Joe Jones spoke as tears ran down his face. And that was when he was a lot meaner looking. And those tears began to run down his face, and ask him what was wrong. And he mentioned to one of the ones that were working in the room with him, he said, I may not have the words exact, but this is what he said. I'm just overwhelmed thinking about the people who will be standing in this room, wait their turn to have their life changed through baptism in Jesus' name. Stepped in that room last night and opened the door and saw that baptismal tank sitting there. It was just a horse trough full of water, but it was a baptismal tank. And looked in there and saw, and those words come rolling back to me. I'm just overwhelmed by the people whose lives are going to be changed. And as we sat through service last night, there was a picture that was up on the altar of some of our men. Some of them had already left at that point, but there was a picture of some of our men when we were working there. And I kept looking at it, thanking God for a church who understands how the kingdom of God works. It's not just about us and what we have to accomplish on our mission field here of DeKalb County, but that the kingdom of God is so much bigger than just our little area. And anything that we can do to help others find their way to God, whether it's in this church or whether it's a church across the state somewhere or across the globe for that matter, whatever we can do to advance the kingdom, that's what we must do. And the return of the Lord is so very, very close for us to just simply coast at this point. We have to absolutely put the vehicle called the church into overdrive and reach anyone that we can, anywhere that we can, anyhow that we can. We need to reach them for the purpose of the kingdom of God. But I want you to see this picture, Brother Brandon, if you could put that up for me. And I don't know if you can see it real well or not, but this is our group of men. Some of us have lost a lot of weight since that picture. But this is our men. But I want you to notice something. As we were sitting there last night, and church had wrapped up, and I had taken a couple of notes on my phone as we were going through service preparing for this morning, I want you to notice the sign that Brother Robinson is holding in his hand. You may not be able to see it from where you're sitting today, but it says the next one. And it shows a picture of a man and a picture of a church and a picture of a city, what they represent. And it says the next one. And Sister C helped me last night to understand what we're doing here today is also creating the next one who will go and labor for the kingdom of God. We have a very unique situation this morning here today in that we are dedicating three boys. I don't know that that's happened in the history of our baby dedications around here. But we are dedicating three boys. Now, please understand, I believe that that girls in dedication and baby dedications, this is going to be a very, very different story here this morning in the way that this goes. And so I want you to understand that I believe that girls can also be involved in this, but please, for the sake of the fact we have three boys and there's men on the picture, please just work with me, okay? I want to speak to these parents in such a way as if I'm commissioning men to service today. Please understand, I believe with everything in me that girls can be part of this, but for the most part, it's men who do this work. And so what I need you to see is that if we don't teach the importance of the temple to these boys, who is going to be the next ones to go? Who will be the next one? Please listen to me today. There will never be a next city reached without a next church to send someone. There will never be someone to send if there's not a preacher to train them and send them. There will never be a preacher to train them and send them if there's not a young man that gets called into ministry. And there will never be a young man called into ministry if there are not parents who show them the importance of the temple. Please hear me today. Sports are okay. Academics are okay. Popularity may be okay, but none of it is okay unless there is first the importance of the temple. Please hear me. I can survive without making it to the college or pro level. I can survive. I can survive if I'm not the most highly decorated educational person on the planet. I can survive. I can survive if no one ever knows who I am. I can survive. But I will never survive if the temple is not the most important thing in my life. I will never survive if I'm not shown the value of a relationship with God in my life. Please hear me this morning. It doesn't matter. And I've seen it happen. And it's been a phase that has moved through all of athletics now. That now when somebody makes a good shot or scores a point or does something great, they tap their chest and they point to heaven. And I'm just telling you, it's okay if that's what they want to do. But I want you to hear me this morning. It doesn't matter how many times you slap your chest and point your finger to heaven. If God is not reflected in what you're doing by how much time you've given Him at the altar, then it really does not matter. This means nothing if you haven't spent time right here in the process. It's got to be backed up by the amount of time that I've spent at the altar. It doesn't mean anything to pat my chest and point to heaven. It doesn't mean anything to put this up if I haven't spent time there. It doesn't matter how popular they may become. It doesn't matter how popular they are and that everybody knows who they are if they haven't been cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ. If they haven't been washed by the blood of Jesus, I want you to understand, it really doesn't matter who knows who they are if they haven't been washed by the blood of Jesus. It doesn't matter. I don't care. Don't even know my name. But I better make sure that I've spent time at the altar, that I've transferred what it means to be at the altar. I've transferred what it means to be washed in His blood and sanctified by His Spirit. I've transferred it to my children because that's what's most important in their lives. It really doesn't matter what accomplishments they have in this life if it's not supported. Please hear me. By the accomplishments in the spiritual that they find from spending time in this place. I need you to hear me. Stand with me. We're going to pray before we bring these families up. We're going to pray. Because this isn't just for these three this morning. This is for every one of us here today. Please understand me. I'm not against athletics. You know I have children that have been in athletics. I'm not against them. But I will tell you this, they never take priority over that. I don't care how good they are. I don't care how blessed they may be with talent. It don't take priority over this. Because you know what? All it takes is a broke leg or a pulled muscle. And that's over with. But this right here, this is what's going to last forever. You want to get them ready for eternity or you want to get them ready to be popular here? Because guess what? Can I be real for just a second? They may never make it to that level before God calls them home for some reason. So you better make sure this is what was made important. Everything else is secondary. Everything else comes second. And I'm not afraid. Listen, I don't know about you, but I'm not afraid to walk up to a coach and say, I'm sorry. I hope it doesn't hurt the team. But this isn't his priority. This isn't his life. And if there's a church event happening and there's any way, shape, or form that he can miss what he's doing, I promise you he's going to be at the church event first. That's first priority. I figured that'd go over about like a lead balloon. Because that's got to be first in his life or in her life. But in this case, the boys, that's got to be first. I don't care how talented they become. If this is not first, it's a waste of time. We love to go watch them play ball, and we love to go watch them hit the tee ball and run around the bases or run at the wrong bases or throw sand in the air, and we just think that's wonderful, and I'm all for that. You know, I go to the games. I go and support them. I go and watch them. That's important. But I'm telling you, please hear me this morning as pastor. Nothing is more important than this right here. I don't care how well known they become. I don't care if they end up valedictorian. I don't care if they end up the most popular person on the church or on the school campus. I don't care who they are. It doesn't matter if they haven't been washed here. Because when they take this and represent this to their community and represent this to their school friends and represent that, this is what's most important to me. And I'm telling you, the accomplishments they make in life mean nothing if they haven't learned how to accomplish working their way through the temple and finding their place here at the ark where the presence of God dwells. If they haven't figured this out, I'm telling you, you're damaging them. And please don't wait. Don't wait till they're teenagers. Don't wait and say, well, I'm going to let them make their own decisions, and then later on in life, they'll get it right. They won't get it right. They won't get it right because they haven't been taught that the temple is the most important place in your life. If we don't teach them the importance of the temple, that will never be a burning desire for the temple and the presence of God in their life. If we don't teach them the importance of the temple, tell them what this is all about. What does this mean, Mom? What does it mean, Dad? Don't just expect the pastor to do it. Don't just expect the youth pastor to do it. Why don't you get in there? Don't expect Sunday school to do it. We're going to do all we can in the time we have. But you better show them every day that this is the most important place in your life. I got to get in the presence of God. Brother Beecham read a quote last night from Woodrow Wilson. His reason for the quote really didn't work out so well, but the quote means a lot when you listen to how it's put into place and what we're doing here today. He said, I would rather fail at a cause that will eventually succeed than to succeed at a cause that will eventually fail. Please hear that for just a second. I'd much rather invest and make mistakes in the process of investing in these lives. I might mess up, Brother Earl. I might make a mistake. I may not get it right one time. You know what? You might get upset one day. You might get mad one day, Tasha. You might just get upset one day. I know that probably never happens in your house. Sorry, didn't mean to call you out. Michael, you know what? There may be a day where you get it wrong, and I didn't really feel like going to church today, and I just didn't do it. And then later on, I feel guilty because I look at my kids and go, they should have been in Sunday school today. I'm just telling you, there might be times when we make a mistake, but I'd much rather fail at investing something in them that's going to last forever than I would to try to succeed at something that's going to fail. Because the things of this life aren't going to get them very far without the temple in their life. So, right here's the next ones. I don't know what God will do with them. I don't know what will end up happening with them. Michael, you got a mama sitting over there. You were raised up in this. You may not be a preacher, but that doesn't mean one of these boys won't be. There's sacrifices and prayers that's been made that if you'll continue to carry it, one of them just might be the next one. Chris and Tasha, where you've come from and what you've done, how do you know? I watch Eli every time he gets up here and starts worshiping. He just might be the next one. This is what's important. Oh, the changes, Earl, that's happened, Megan, that's happened in your life, what God has done with you. You know what's wonderful about it is that Zoe and Tristan are never going to have to know what that was. Because now all they know is this. This is all they know. All they know is what it takes to get in the temple and what it takes to get to the presence of God. That's all they're going to know. Because that's what I'm going to do. teach them. Because what's not taught is not learned. And so I'd much rather succeed in this than I would, even though I might make mistakes. You're not going to get it perfect. None of us do. Anybody who thinks they got it all figured out on how to raise kids, they don't have a clue. Because every one of them are different. Every one of them do something different. You think you got it figured out with this one, and that one's going to change everything, I promise you. I've heard people that have had one child tell me they know how to raise kids. You don't have a clue. You know how to raise one. But you don't know what sibling rivalries are. You don't know what different personalities in the house are. This one might do it one way, and this one might do it completely opposite. You love this one. You're really questioning this one. I'm just telling you how it feels. But I wonder if across this room we'll just lift our hands today. And we're going to give some Bibles, and then we're going to sing before we go here today. And I've already spoken. To you today, and so we're just going to hand them a Bible, and then we're going to pray. So little Jonah, little man, God's going to use him. A lot of heritage right now that's at stake. Show him the importance of the temple, Michael. Let him see it. Chris and Tasha, I love you. You know that, right? I love them kids. I think you got one preacher that's in the bunch, but you might have another one right behind him. And as I watch that little girl, she's going to be involved in ministry. If you teach her, take that for a little Bentley. Smiling. Earl, Megan, God's going to do great things with you. You've already seen him change your life. Man, how dramatically he's changed. And the story that's right here. But the story that's being written is even greater than the story that's happening. He's in his little suit today. Might be something he gets used to wearing. Show him how important the temple is. Show him how important it is. If you all will stand up here, and I want their family to come in behind them and just kind of spread out a little bit. Let family come in behind them this morning. If you guys will pull this one just a little bit so there's room. I want your family to come in and step in behind them. And Megan, I know you may not have family coming down like these do, but I want you just to look around this room and realize you got a church family that's supporting you and that's behind you. We're going to be all right. We're going to make it. In Jesus' name. I want you to help me pray here this morning. Andrew, if you can give me the oil so I can pray for each one of us. And we're going to ask God to touch us here today. Can you help us today? This is for all of us as much as it is for these that are here today. The temple's got to be the most important place in their life. Temple's got to be important. We got to teach them that it's important. Point your hands this way and let's pray for them. In Jesus' name. You've called me.
Why don't you grab somebody's hand next to you? Let's just pray right now. Come on, if you got family nearby you, we need to make a rededication right now. We need to make a rededication that this is what's most important in my life. Come on, if your children are nearby you, why don't you grab them and just say, this is what's important in our lives. Nothing matters like the temple. Nothing is more important than the temple. Come on, right now, why don't you just let God begin to wash over you today? God, rededicate me. God, recommit me. God, let me have that passion back in me. God, that this is the most important place. The temple is the most important place. In Jesus' name. I hope that some way this morning you have caught the vision of transfer. This generation has to praise his works to the next generation. And I'm just asking you as your pastor, don't wait too long. Don't wait too long to show them the importance of the temple. Because this is the most important thing in their lives. I can remember times when my children were young and we'd be stuck at the church and I'd come out of the office and they'd be sitting against the wall. You know, there was never a complaint. I might have come out of the office and they said, I'm hungry. Can we go get something to eat? But there was never a complaint about being in the temple. Because they just knew it's what we do. It's what we do. And if I can go sit at a ball game for hours, if I can go sit at some performance for hours, I ought to be able to give the temple some of my time. I ought to be able to teach them that the temple's more important. Because this is where I want you to have eternity built. Because this is all that matters. We never know what tomorrow holds. I got a notification on my phone this morning. There's been 50 people killed in a nightclub in Orlando last night. From one guy walking in and shooting them up. Now, I understand our kids shouldn't be in that nightclub, so we won't have to worry about that. But that doesn't mean something might not happen in their lives that would rob them from us. And so I better make sure I've invested what's important in their lives. Even more important than that, I don't know how much time I've got to invest in their lives. Because I may not be here tomorrow. And what are they going to say about Dad if I pass? If I'm gone tomorrow, what are my kids going to say? Dad taught us how to make money. Dad taught us how to play ball. Our dad told us that the temple was the most important place. What are they going to say? They're going to say whatever I've made important. Whatever I've made important is what they're going to say. Bow our heads one more time. Lord, we love you. God, we thank you. God, for your mercy and your grace, God, that overshadows, God, our faults and our failures, God, our mistakes that we make. God, I thank you for your love. I thank you for your grace. God, I pray, Lord, that not just these couples that are here dedicating their children today, but God, let every one of us, God, from this pulpit to the back door included, God, reestablish and rededicate God, and make some priorities where they need to be in my life. God, that the temple is the most important place in my life. God, my relationship with you is the most important thing in my life. God, help me to transfer that to the next generation. God, help me to transfer it by showing how much I trust you, by showing how much faith I have that you're going to see us through. Let me transfer it by showing how important you are to me. In Jesus' precious name. God, go with us today. God, bring us back to your house tonight. God, expecting a move of your spirit. In Jesus' mighty name.